Well, I'm finally done building the perfect 3D printer bed for my Voron. If you want to learn why it's so great and how to build your own, keep watching this video. If you clicked on this video expecting me to talk about some other type of bed, well, enjoy the light show, I guess. Anyway, get ready to learn more about beds than you ever thought you wanted to. We'll be going over everything from hardware to software and even a little bit of physics and AI. So what does a 3D printer bed actually do? The main purpose is to serve as a flat surface on which we can build up plastic to build our parts. Usually, to improve stickiness of plastic to the bed, most printers also heat up the bed to between 50 and 100 degrees Celsius. To do this, usually beds have a top plate, which is a sticky material like glass or PEI, with a heater beneath it. Also note that on most printers, the bed also doubles as one of the three movement axes, so that the extruder only needs to move in the other two directions, but there are some printers like the Voron 2 which have a completely fixed bed. On the Voron 0, the bed is attached with a metal frame that moves up and down. If you follow the stock Voron 0 instructions, you'd end up building one of these frames. The problem is that while we're printing, we're going to be making thousands of fast up and down movements which are going to make the bed frame shake and reduce our accuracy. The stock bed is fairly heavy, weighing at 135 grams and hinges on these small plastic parts which are fairly flimsy. How flimsy, you might ask? Well, I measured the bed by rigidly attaching it to an aluminum frame and measuring the deflection when you add 1 kilogram to the end. The result is around a half millimeter of deflection, which isn't great when you compare it to our average layer height when printing, which is 0.2 millimeters. You can probably tell by now that we're not going to be using this bed frame. Instead, we're going to be using this bed frame, which I designed in CAD in order to be machined out of aluminum. Of course, I'm not the first person to try to improve the stock bed. There's also the popular Kirigami bed mod, which is made out of folded aluminum or steel. The problem is that these have a very thin piece of metal near the rails, which makes it weaker. You will even find people on the internet who have designed brackets like these that further reinforce the bed. But aside from the steel one, which is super heavy, the regular Kirigami bed and my custom one are a little bit lighter than the stock bed. In terms of deflection strength, since I have the 3D models for both of these bed frames, I ran a simulation and theoretically under the same 1 kilogram weight as before, the aluminum Kirigami bed should deflect around 0.58 millimeters, while my bed should deflect basically 0 millimeters. Simulations are naturally never as good as real life, so I also tested this on a real frame like before. The first time I did this, I just attached the frames to the regular linear rails, but for whatever reason, my frame had way more than zero deflection in this setup. So I redid some of the tests using these rigid mounting brackets. Here's a quick summary of the results. My general conclusion is my original tests in my CNC bed with the non-rigid setup had around 0.2 millimeters of error just from the linear rails being imprecise. So the CNC bed itself is probably optimal as is and way stronger than the other options out there. Note that there's also multi-belt mods for the Voron 0 and other printers which support the bed from more than one side to mitigate this issue, but this requires you to coordinate multiple motors for the Z-axis. So based on this, I'm going to stick with my bed frame for now. You can watch part one of this build series linked in the video description if you want to see how to attach the bed to the 3D printer frame. On top of the bed frame, I'm going to be using this Provoc 3D aluminum bed with a heater backing and these PEI sheets magnetically attached to the top. Now, there are several variations of this design out in the wild. Just looking at the other 3D printers I own, my Prusas also have magnetic PEI sheets, but opt for a PCB heater directly below it with a thin aluminum frame below that. I also have this E3D tool changer, which just uses a glass sheet with a heater pad below that. Regardless of which design you're using, the most important factor is making sure it stays flat to get a flat surface on your printed parts. Aluminum beds like these tend to be fairly popular in the Voron community since they can be milled flat and conduct heat well, so they will provide fairly even heating across the whole surface. We'll measure the flatness in a later video once we get the bed leveling. The disadvantage of this bed is that the aluminum expands a lot when heated, so to keep it flat at high temperature, it needs to be very thick. The Provoc 3D aluminum bed I'm using is a whopping 10 millimeters thick. A bigger slab of metal also means that it'll take more energy and longer to heat up and cool down. To get around this issue, the Provoc bed has this close to 300 watt mica heater. For reference, this is the next best Voron 0 bed from LDO, which just has a 100 watt heater and similar aluminum bed. So our bed should take around a third of the time to heat up at the start of each print. The standard electrical wiring for Voron beds looks like this. 120 volt AC coming out of your wall power socket is converted with a power supply to a more manageable 24 volts, which is then used for the bed and other electronics. The issue with this is the power supply is not completely efficient and may lose 5 to 10% of the power in the conversion process to heat, so it doesn't scale well to higher wattages. So instead, the mica heater is designed to directly run off of AC. This also requires adding a solid state relay, which is a fancy switch that you can use to turn on and off the AC power to the bed. Now I'll give the obligatory warning that dealing with AC voltage is dangerous and that you should consult with a professional before doing any of this at home. I'll now set up the wiring in the bottom of the Voron to prepare for this new bed. Here, the wire coloring is black and white for the neutral and live AC wires and blue for the ground. To make space, I also switched to using a smaller power supply than the one in the Voron bomb. Lastly, you want to attach the blue ground wire to your printer frame for safety reasons in case there is a wiring issue later. Assuming you've tightened all the screws connecting the aluminum extrusions enough, all the aluminum extrusions should be electrically connected, so you only need to connect the blue wire to one of them. In my case, I didn't tighten them enough, so I'm making multiple connections to the frame. Make sure to verify with the multimeter in continuity mode that all the extrusions are electrically connected together by probing all pairs of end holes. Next, let's move on to the electronics. So I'm planning on kitting out my bed with a lot of smart features like RGB LEDs, fans, and multiple temperature sensors to monitor the bed. The classical approach is to run wires back to the main control board for each of these components. But since this requires routing a lot of wires, I opted for the approach that some newer printers take by creating a separate board that sits under the bed and communicates back to the main controller with a single wire. This is somewhat similar to the average USB cable, which you can use to connect electronics back to your computer. Internally, older USB connectors just have four wires, two power wires and two data wires, D plus and D minus, but effectively they just act as one data line in a differential pair to reduce noise. Since there is effectively just one data line, the host always initiates communications to avoid two devices sending data at the same time. Then the requested device can send back data within some time window. My board does something similar with just one wire. Since this is noisier than a two-wire differential pair, we are running at a slower 115k bits per second compared to the megabits per second in USB. And similarly to USB, each packet ends with a checksum byte, which the receiver can use to detect if a received packet is corrupted. Okay, let's get to installing this stuff on the printer. First thing we'll do is glue some WIGO connectors to the bed frame. Then we'll attach the fan. Note that for now we are just temporarily installing all the parts to measure how long we need to cut the wires. Now we can attach the bed board. Note that the screw in the outer corner of the bed is slightly longer to use for mounting your grounding wire later. Next, we'll go back to installing the bed standoffs to keep the hotbed away from the frame. The next best step to follow is to install the RGB LED. And we can now attach the bed on top of that. Note that when you get the bed, it'll still have very long heater wires and no temperature sensor installed yet. To install the temperature sensor in the bed, I first tried to put some thermal grease in the hole. Unfortunately, this ended up making a huge mess that I needed to clean up. But after that was cleaned up, we can slide in the temperature sensor cartridge. After all the cables are routed, I sealed the temperature sensor in place with silicone glue. And we can now cut all the wires to the right length. Off camera, I disassembled everything and crimped on connectors to all the wires so we can reassemble everything for real this time. This time, we also add a blue grounding wire to the longer bed board screw right below the nut. For safety purposes, make sure with a multimeter in continuity mode that the bed metal is electrically connected to the ground wire screw. If not, the screws aren't tight enough. Then we can attach the bed heater wires to the top hole of the WIGO connectors. Longer AC power wires will go into the other hole in the WIGO connectors. Lastly, we'll route and attach the wire harness for the bed board. We're now going to organize the cables outside of the bed frame by reattaching the 3D printed cable chain adapter. I apologize for the top screw being really annoying to insert. The cables can then go through the cable chain. The easiest way to do this is tape the wire bundle together and then push it through the chain. Before we can reattach the bed to the rails, we'll hook up the cable chain to the printer floor. To do this, you'll probably need to remove the mid plate temporarily to make space for pressing in the connector. And now comes the very annoying task of reinserting all these tiny screws which just barely fit. Just be sure to use Loctite this time when you attach the M2 screws for the linear rails. Before I fully tightened all the screws, I used the Level app on my phone to make sure the bed is still roughly level with the printer. Coming back to the wiring, now is a good time to finish attaching the bed heater wires to power in the bottom of the printer. So we're done with all the bed hardware. So how do we actually make this do something useful? Naively, we just turn on the bed until we reach our desired temperature and then turn it off. But there are some issues with this. First, it takes time for the heat from the heater to reach the other side of the bed. So even if we instantly turn off the bed will just keep heating up for several seconds. Second, we mainly care about the temperature on top of the print bed, but our temperature probe is located relatively far away. So for the same reason, won't give us the right temperature. Some beds like the LDO one partially solve this issue by drilling a deep hole in the middle of the bed for the temperature sensor, but even this can't get the exact sheet temperature. Most 3D printer firmwares will use the PID control algorithm to solve this problem. This works well, but there is no guarantee that you're getting an optimal result. Also, it's 2025 and I gotta make this video somehow AI related to get views, so we're gonna be solving this problem by building some models. First thing we need is training data, so I wired up some quick and dirty electronics to control the bed for my computer and attached another temperature sensor to the top of the sheet, which plugs into one of the extra ports on my bedboard. Since this is going to be boring to look at, I'll just be showing the view through this thermal camera. Then we just need to run the bed through various heating and cooling cycles while collecting all this data. Something to notice is that the internal bed temperature is always a little bit higher than the sheet temperature during heating, which is as we'd expect. Also, even after the heater is turned off, the bed and sheet keep heating up due to the lag time needed for heat transfer. Once I did one set of heating and cooling cycles, I repeated the experiment with the fan turned on. Here's what the data looks like if we zoom out. So now we just need to figure out how to build a model, which, given some target temperature, will predict what heater and fan inputs we need to provide. We're gonna do this in two steps. First, we're gonna build a model that, given some heater and fan inputs, will tell us what the eventual temperature will be. Second, we'll use some algorithm to generate control inputs and evaluate their correctness against the model. So how are we gonna model the behavior of the aluminum bed? So the bed itself, we're gonna model as a heater, a bottom third, middle third, where our main temperature sensor is located, and a top third of the aluminum. Also, we need to incorporate nodes for the ambient air, which will pass cool down the bed, and the fan, which we can use to actively cool down the bed faster or make the air hotter. Our model basically needs to be a simulation of the temperature changes over time. At each point in time, each node has some temperature or controllable power level, and we want to predict the next temperature at some future point in time. To do this, the simulation will need to know how the different nodes affect each other. I asked Gemini for an answer to this, and it found some basic physics equations we can use. First, we assume that the heater immediately dumps its heat into the bottom element, so we just add some multiple of the heater's power level to the bottom temperature after some small interval of time. To model the aluminum, we'll use Fourier's law of heat conduction. This basically just says that if we have two adjacent objects A and B, they will exchange energy at some rate proportional to their difference in temperature. Note that we are simplifying this a bit here and assuming that temperature and energy are interchangeable, which is roughly correct since our bed is mostly one material. The relationship between the air and the blocks is similar. Technically, it's also proportional to the surface area of the metal exposed to the air. You can read more about this by Googling Newton's law of cooling. Lastly, we have the fan equation, which cools down the bottom of the bed at each time step. It's a mix of the other equations since it will cool down the bed faster if the air is much cooler than the bed. What you may have noticed is that we don't know any of the four weights A, B, C, or D yet. The easiest way to find these is to use gradient descent in a similar way to training AI models. First, we start with some arbitrary set of values and simulate the future temperatures using the equations we just discussed. Then we look at each weight individually and see if making it slightly larger or smaller will improve our fit to the training data. If we do this a few thousand times, we'll get a pretty good fit. Now we have an accurate model that we can use to predict behavior of a bed given some set of heater and fan percentage inputs. To actually control the bed, we need to do basically the same thing, but find a list of weights which are the percentage of power we should feed to the heater and fan at each time step. Similarly, we'll start with some arbitrary initial values and use an error function that measures our distance away from a fixed temperature target. Now we can give these inputs to our real bed. Note that since our model isn't perfect, we only give the real bed the first control input in our sequence and recompute the rest of the sequence once we have remeasured the temperature a few seconds later. Another thing I should mention is that the control inputs are quantized since the relays can't instantly switch on and off AC power safely and can only do this at around 120 times per second. Similarly, we can do this for commanding the bed to cool down with a model smart enough to know to use the fan. Lastly, I should mention that this approach is somewhat similar to the model predictive control algorithm that can be enabled in some firmwares like Voron, except MPC usually involves more specialized methods of solving these differential equations. Okay, that's all for this video. In the next video, hopefully we'll actually start melting plastic. Bye!